Hi, this is the second video in our series on sprint planning in JIRA. In the first part, I spoke about how to prepare for the session and what topics you need to cover. Now, if you missed out on that video, go check it out. I'll put a link on the screen now, and you'll also find a link in the description below. Now, in that video, I did mention there were two ways for a team to figure out what they can achieve within a sprint. They can either use their velocity, which is based on their story point estimates, or they could use a time-based approach. Now, in this video, I'm going to focus on how to use the team's velocity. But don't worry, if you still want to know how to use time, I will cover that, but it'll be in the next video in this series. Okay. Let's get to it. Let's check out how we can run an effective sprint planning session through using a team's velocity based on their story point estimates. Before you decide to use velocity for your sprint planning session, it's first very important that everybody actually understands how it works. Velocity and story point values. Now, those two terms actually come from an approach called relative estimation. And if you're new to it, or if your team is, go check out this blog post. I'll place a link to it in the description below. Now, I do know relative estimation is difficult to understand. So if you would like me to create a video on it, it might be something that's useful to you or for you to share with your team. Let me know. Okay, put a message in the comments below and say, hey, Richard, I'd like you to create a video on it. And if I get enough people asking for it, I will. Okay, so assuming that you and your team understand what velocity is and story point values, the first step will be for us to figure out what is the team's velocity. Now, how do you do that in JIRA? I'll show you right now. To calculate velocity in JIRA, you'll need to have run a few sprints, and the product backlog items within those sprints need to have story points associated with them. If you don't know how to associate story points to product backlog items, go check out our video on getting your product backlog in JIRA right. I'll place a link to that on the screen now, and you'll also find it in the description below. So assuming you've run a few sprints, you can use JIRA's velocity chart to calculate velocity. If you haven't seen it before, you can go over to reports here on the left. When you click on that, you'll notice that the velocity chart is an option. So clicking on velocity chart, you'll notice that it shows you a couple of values per sprint. The first value, indicated by the gray bar here, is the committed number of points. So the committed number of points is the amount of work that the team thought they could achieve in that sprint. The second value per sprint that it gives you is the actual number of points that the team achieved, the completed number of story points, and that's the green bar here. So the green bar, the completed number of points, is what we want to use. To calculate velocity for usage in sprint planning, what I like to do is keep it simple, and I take the average of the last three sprints. So you can see here for this team, in sprint three, they managed to get through 21 points, in sprint four, 18, sprint five, 26. So what I would do is I'd say, okay, let's take 21 plus 18 plus 26, divide it by three, which is somewhere around 22 points, and that would be the average velocity that we use for sprint planning to determine what they can get done in the upcoming sprint. If you would like a more advanced approach to calculating velocity, then go check out Mike Cohen's Velocity Range Calculator. I'll place a link to it in the description below. This calculator actually uses statistical analysis, and it'll give you what it calls 90% confidence that your team's velocity will be in a certain range. So it's a really cool tool, go check it out, but know that you'll need to have at least 5 sprints of data to use it. Lastly, when it comes to velocity, there are a few points that you want to keep in mind. Firstly, the more sprints the team does, the more reliable that metric will be. So if you're in the early days, you're just doing your initial sprints, you might find that the velocity isn't all that accurate. Okay, but don't worry, after your team gets through a few sprints, it will start to stabilize. Secondly, to make sure your velocity metric is reliable, you will need to keep two variables consistent. And the first variable is the team sprint length. If your team is in the habit of chopping and changing their sprint length, then what's going to happen? Your velocity will go up and down. Again, it will not be reliable. In the early days of perhaps your Scrum implementation, it's okay to experiment with sprint lengths, but once you decide on what works for you and your team, then stick to it. If it keeps on going up and down, again, the velocity metric will not work for you. So a consistent sprint length is very important to making this work, and so is a stable team. That's the second variable that you want to be mindful of. Now, what do I mean by a stable team? If your team is being changed each sprint, in other words, if you've got new people joining the team or people being replaced over and over again, that will also impact your velocity and make it very unreliable. So again, if you're applying this, make sure your team has a consistent sprint length. And secondly, they are part of a stable team that is not changing too often. Finally, you do want to consider if anyone is going to be perhaps on leave that sprint, okay, and reduce the points accordingly, and other types of factors that could impact your sprint. This could be public holidays, it could be company events. So make sure you reduce the points as need be. Now that we've calculated velocity, we have an idea of the capacity of the team and what they can fit into the sprint. So to determine what they're going to get done inside that sprint, we head back over to the product backlog view. The way I like to run a sprint planning session is I actually divide it into two parts. And the difference between the two parts is who gets involved and what we discuss. So the first part is where we don't just have the Scrum Master and the delivery team there, but also the product owner. So the first part of sprint planning is to ask the product owner any final questions to clarify the top priorities. So this might be the items towards the top here. Okay, we'd have a look. We're not going to go too far down. Let's imagine my team has a velocity of 22. So we're only going to go down this product backlog and cover off, you know, somewhere around 20, 25 points, maybe 30 points max. So again, we just ask questions, we clarify before we get into the second part of sprint planning. Just a point to note, this first part where you involve the product owner is really just a formality. It's a tick in the box, and sometimes you can get away with not even doing it. I say that because if you've been proactively refining your product backlog, any questions that need to be answered probably have already been answered. Okay, so sometimes you can get away with not doing that first part and just get straight into the second part. So what's the second part of sprint planning? This is where we're going to determine what we're going to get done inside the sprint. And for this second part, we only need the Scrum Master and the delivery team. To determine what we can get done within the sprint, we need to understand how the work is going to get done. So in this second part, we're going to discuss product backlog item by product backlog item and really delve into the detail. So for example, I like teams to work in priority order. So we start from the top of the product backlog, we bring it into the sprint, and we're going to start talking about certain details about this user story to make sure that we're well prepared for the upcoming sprint. So there are a few points that you'll want to discuss about each product backlog item. Number one, clarify the technical implementation. what's involved, and who's doing what work. You'll be working with a cross-functional team in Scrum, people with different skill sets contributing to the product backlog item in different ways. So make sure you capture that, okay? Capture it inside the user story, inside the product backlog item. Secondly, consider dependencies. There's going to be many types of dependencies out there. Your team may need to integrate with a third-party API or another system. They may rely on a subject matter expert or a person from another team to support them in this implementation. So consider the dependencies that the team has and make sure that that's somehow considered and baked into your sprint plan as well. Again, capture it in the user story. Thirdly, discuss any risks. Things to look out for. So it may be that the team is working with a new technology. They may get it wrong. Okay, consider that. It may be that somebody is away that sprint, and typically they would be there to support the team, and because they're not around, there's going to be a level of risk. So if you think about those risks in advance and you bring it up with the team, you're more likely to achieve a successful plan because you've seen it and you've prepared for it. So this information, you can capture it on your product backlog item, either in the description or in the comments, if you like as well. There's a comments section with issues in Jira, or even as attachments. Okay, you can attach additional information. After you've gone through those points for the product backlog item, we then keep going. We move on to the next product backlog item. So we bring that in and again, go through those points. Talk about the technical details, dependencies, risks, and we keep on going until we reach the team's velocity that we calculated before. So you'll notice the number of points we've added to the sprint down here. Okay, so you can see we're up to 11 points. So we keep on going, okay? So I go up to 16, the team can see, hey, we can still fit in a little more. So we go again, there we go. We've hit 21. Now, at this point, you can see that we've got one extra point where I said that the team had a velocity of 22. So there's a few things you can do at this stage. You might be tempted to go and bring in the next item. So you can see, for example, this next item it's only 3 points and it's going to exceed our velocity. So it says a total of 24, but we can only really get 22 done. You could do that. I tend not to encourage that. A lot of teams they use what's called stretch goals, and they'll say, hey, product owner, if we can, we'll try and get that one in. But if we don't have enough time, we're not going to do it. Now, I don't really like stretch goals because in the end, what tends to sometimes happen is people expect those items to actually get done. And they don't get done, and then product owners and stakeholders get upset. Okay? So instead of dragging in another item and exceeding your velocity limit, what I like to do is, firstly, we could talk to the product owner and say, hey, is there another item in here, maybe a one pointer that we could squeeze in? It's going to be lower priority, but we can put it in there. We should be able to achieve it. So you could do that. Or you could not pull in an item. You don't necessarily need to go all the way up to your calculated velocity. Instead, you can leave that as like a buffer. And that buffer time can be very useful. You can use it on a number of things. For example, you could pay down technical debt. Most software teams have technical debt and they wish they had time to pay it down, to refactor and to clean up code. Leave the spare time for that. Or secondly, you could work on some process improvements. Okay, look at ways you could make the way you're implementing the work easier, quicker, better. Maybe you leverage test automation or deployment automation, do some of that work. You could spend the time doing product backlog refinement, looking ahead and saying, hey, do we need more details? Or lastly, you could, if you have enough spare points, you could actually schedule what's called an innovation day. Atlassian are actually well known for doing this. They have seen some amazing creations just by allowing a team to build whatever they want for an entire day. So of course, we're assuming that you can set aside a whole day, that you've got enough points to do so for the entire team. But an innovation day is a potential option as well. Okay, so don't necessarily just try to fill it up to the team's capacity. You can certainly leave some of those points as a buffer to, again, help with process improvements, pay down technical debt, have an innovation day, product backlog refinement, or just leave it just in case. At the end of the session, take a step back and perform a final review of the sprint plan, asking the team if they feel it's realistic, making sure they have considered the sequencing and whether that work looks like it can actually get done. And then you're ready. You can hit that start sprint button. So there you have it. That is how we conduct a sprint planning session using a team's velocity and their story point estimates. Now, before you go, let's talk about a few pros and cons with this approach that you need to consider. So, in terms of pros, using a team's velocity for sprint planning is quicker than using time. So that means a session will be shorter and you can use the additional time for other things. So that's one benefit. Secondly, you'll find that some team members tend to feel more comfortable when it comes to talking about estimating in terms of points than in terms of time. I've met lots of people out there who feel very uncomfortable trying to come up with a sprint plan in terms of time. Sometimes they interpret that as generating urgency or micromanaging. And we'll talk more about that in the next video. But again, some team members don't feel comfortable talking about time-based estimates and they prefer the story points. Let's talk about the cons now. So firstly, you'll find that you're going to need the team to run a few sprints before your velocity is reliable. In the early days, the velocity will fluctuate. The team might apply the approach incorrectly. So you're going to need to wait for usually at least 3 to 4 sprints before you get a reasonable velocity to use. So that's the first point. Secondly, story points are not as precise as time-based estimation. So for example, if you have a less experienced developer on your team and a more experienced developer, the less experienced developer is obviously going to take more time to get the work done than the more experienced developer. However, when you use story points with your sprint planning, that often isn't evident. So sometimes it means that the team's sprint plan isn't as precise as it could be. Lastly, using story points, it can be a hard approach to understand. And there's a level of risk that people out there misunderstand how to apply it correctly. I do see this quite often. So it is a hard approach to understand, and also it can be confusing for your stakeholders. Okay, so just be mindful of that. Now, I'd love to hear your experiences with using story points and velocity for sprint planning. Have you seen it work really well? Have you not? Are there other pros and cons that I didn't mention? Please share it in the comments below. I'd love to hear them. And lastly, okay, you probably noticed that I didn't mention anything about subtasks in Jira. And some of you are probably wondering, where do subtasks come into it? Should we use them at sprint planning? Do not worry, I am going to talk about those in the next video when we get into time-based estimation for sprint planning. Okay, so if you haven't already, please subscribe, hit that bell icon, and you'll be notified when the next video comes out. Okay, thanks very much, everyone. I'll see you next time.